Hi, everybody. Thanks so much for joining us. My name is Michael Liu. I'm the Dean of the School of Public Health at UC Berkeley. And it is my greatest honor and greatest pleasure to introduce to you all my dear colleague and friend for more than 20 years.
Yes.
And really someone I have the greatest love and admiration for, the Surgeon General of the State of California, Dr. Diana Ramos.
Thank you.
So last September, Governor Newsom appointed Dr. Ramos as the second Surgeon General of California, succeeding Dr. Nadine Burke, who was actually my first guest speaker when I became dean 3.5 years ago. In doing so, Dr. Ramos became the first Latinx state Surgeon General in our nation's history. Dr. Ramos is trained as an OBGYN. She got her MPH from UCLA, her MBA from UC Irvine, and her MD from the Keck School of Medicine at USC, where she has held an adjunct clinical professor appointment since 1999. Now, when I was a faculty at UCLA, I actually got to work very closely with Dr. Ramos in her role as the Director of Reproductive Health for the Department of Public Health for Los Angeles County, and that's between 2005 and 2017, before she became the Public Health Medical Officer for the California Department of Public Health from 2017 to 2021. So when she became appointed as the Surgeon General last year, all of us who had the good fortune of working with Diana just were ecstatic, because she really is somebody that all of us look up to for her leadership, her competency, her integrity, and her compassion. And we're just so happy and so proud that you're the top doctor for our state. So welcome, Diana.
Thank you, and I wanna say thank you, Michael, Dr. Liu. You are leading an amazing school of public health. And as Dr. Liu had mentioned, he and I have worked together for over 20 years. Locally, statewide, nationally, and I personally have always been an admirer and just so honored by your leadership, learned so much. So thank you. I think it's a mutual admiration club here, so thank you.
So I'm going to start by engaging Diana in a one-on-one conversation, and I'll try, I actually received several advanced questions, so I'll try to weave those questions into our conversation, but then we'll open it up for Q&A from the audience. But let me go ahead and start by asking you, how the heck are you? Like, what is it like to be a Surgeon General for the state of California?
So it is an honor and a privilege. I am very humbled to be in this position, and I represent the voice of, I think, the majority of Californians in terms of having come from an environment where opportunities are not always available. I had shared with some students earlier that I grew up near South Central LA, single mom who came from Mexico when she was 16. She would work 2-3 jobs at a time to try and provide the best education she could afford. And I was a latchkey kid. So my cousin got pregnant when she was 16 years old. All the social determinants of health, I didn't know that that's what they were called. That's where I grew up around. You know, the helicopter would come around because there was domestic violence in the apartment across the way. You would hear gunshots in the neighborhood. I didn't know any different. And so for me to be able to be here and be now, like you said, Michael, the top doctor, I can say that I come with the lived experience from what many of our Californian residents are experiencing, but then more importantly, the public health community experience that I have learned throughout the years from my work in Los Angeles County, collaboration with counties throughout the state, and partnerships nationally. So you can be sure that I am the voice not only for Californians, but for physicians, for experience, for cross collaboration, it is a privilege. Every day is a single, is very different. There is no one day that things are the same. One day I could be having all day Zoom meetings, and then the next day I'm filming a video, doing a podcast, you know, doing presentations and working on a PowerPoint. It is a labor of love. And so oftentimes I'm asked, well, when are you going to change this? And when are you going to change this? We need more, whatever it is. And I all I can say is I hear you. It's been 6 months that I've been in office. And so for any of you who have recently started a job, you know, it takes about a year to figure out what you're really doing. So I've had to jump in, and I am just so privileged. And I really would love to hear from all of you as to what are some opportunities for my office to help spearhead and lead. So thank you.
So Diana, tell us something about yourself that we cannot find in your CV. Maybe something about, say, your background, some story from childhood, like whatever you're comfortable sharing, that may help explain what drives you to do all the amazing things that you've done in your career, and what's driving your priorities now as the Surgeon General for California.
Yeah, so something that really drives me is probably helping others. As I mentioned, I came from a challenging background, but because of where I am now, I know that, you know, to those who much is given, much is expected. And I always try and support and help and mentor students, people who maybe are doubting themselves that they can accomplish their goals. And so that's probably one reason, and that probably also stems from the fact that my grandmother had a third grade education, but she always was wanting to improve herself no matter what. So I remember even as she was in her 70s and trying to still learn how to read, and she would say, Mija, you have to make sure that you get the best education that you possibly can. And when you do, you have to remember to help your cousins, because I'm an only child, help your cousins and help your uncle. My uncle was a year younger than me, and make sure that he really gets an education. And so it is that drive, and this kind of touches into the ACEs, adverse childhood experiences. It's those loving relationships that surrounded me growing up that really buffered all of the negative stuff that was around me. And it's remembering that even though no matter how hard things are, I always have my family, the love from my family and acceptance to be supporting me. So, you know, sometimes when I have really rough days, my husband reminds me, not everyone's gonna love you. But then my son wrote in the note, no mommy, but I will always love you. I'm like, okay.
So like how does that background inform your priorities as Surgeon General? Like what do you hope to accomplish in the next 5 years?
So I love how you teed me up, thank you. So as part of the Surgeon General role, it is codified in statute that adverse childhood experiences be a part of what is covered, what is addressed. And so when I took the office, I knew what adverse childhood experiences were and the role, but I really didn't understand the upstream, the impact that it really has, not just on the trajectory for a person's life, but really healthcare overall. And so again, those adverse childhood experiences that, you know, we now have a label for that I experienced, I know were buffered, and I was able to overcome because of all of the positive stuff that I was surrounded with. So that informs me, you know, when somebody says, you know, I don't know that we're going to be able to help this person because of the fact that they don't have a ride to get to the doctor's office. And I could say, well, you know what? I remember taking the bus every day to not only go to school, but when I had to go to the doctor. And just to remind people that, okay, sometimes we have to undergo some challenging experiences, but it's those experiences that are going to help you get to your goal. So having those lived experiences are really helpful. The other things that I'm focusing on is mental health. We all know that mental health has impacted all of us, made it worse as a result of COVID. Not that it wasn't there already, but it has just made it worse. It just pulled the curtain on everything that was happening. And we're now even more aware, and we realize that people of color are disproportionately impacted even more. And really, we all have an opportunity right now to make a difference, because the governor has invested over $4.7 billion in a program called the Children Youth Behavioral Health Initiative. And you may be thinking, children, that's not going to apply to me. Well, it's from age zero to 25 years old. And so when I found that out as an OBGYN, I thought, wow, you know what? I saw a lot of unintended pregnancies. I saw a lot of risky behaviors. This transitional age, the 18 to 25 year olds, this is the age where we have the opportunity to make a difference. Many of you are fresh. We met a freshman here who's in school. You know, you're at that age when we know that mental health will develop by 50% of mental health disorders develop by age 14, 75% develop by age 25, 24. So this is the opportunity to make a difference. And so that's why my office is focusing on mental health issues, specifically 18 to 25. So that's my piece of the pie, because a lot of our sister agencies are focusing on the rest of the age groups. Mm. And then the other piece too, as an OBGYN, you know, I have to prioritize what is what I've been trained to do all my life, and that's women's health. And so really looking at the life course of reproductive life, and that is from contraception to preconception health to, and I smile because I think of all the work that we did in preconception health when early on in our careers, and you know, you took it nationally, and here I am now promoting it even more statewide. But then for those women who are in a situation where the pregnancy is not the right time for whatever reason, the abortion services, and then the other is the supporting those pregnancies and hoping to get a better morbidity, mortality rate, the work that we need to do here in California. So focusing along that trajectory.
Well, if I can do deeper dive on each of these three priorities that you listed, so it's the ACEs, mental health, and reproductive health, right? And so starting with ACEs, you know, certainly your predecessor put ACEs on the map, right? To bring national and global attention to the long-term effect of ACEs, the adverse childhood experiences. What would success look like for you? Say 5 years from now, in advancing this agenda?
So I think on a national basis, this could happen. So how many of you are familiar with the Women's Preventive Service Initiative? Okay, this is an opportunity for all of you to learn, really important. The Women's Preventive Service Initiative is a HRSA-sponsored grant, and that was started as a result of Dr. Liu when he was at MCAH. So thank you so much, because it was his vision and his belief that if we really focused what is a priority in women's health, and it is a covered benefit, if we know what preventive services should be given to women, health will be improved along the life course, right? Medicine is really reactive. We are not preventing. So thank you, Dr. Liu. We're now in the second cycle of the five-year grant. But the Women's Preventive Service Initiative is like the equivalent of the U.S. Preventive Task Force. How many of you have heard of the U.S. Preventive Task Force? Everybody, right? So we know that those are evident. It goes through a very evidence review, and there's public commenting, and anything that is A or B recommendation is a covered benefit by the ACA and by grandfather plans. So that's the same thing for the Women's Preventive Service Initiative. It's the benefits that are preventive services for women. So this is specifically calling out women. So success, and this just happened at our last, I'm on the advisory board as well as the dissemination committee, co-chair. But success would be having ACEs as a WPSI benefit. Huh. So it was, and it wasn't offered by me. It was offered by somebody in the public as a recommendation. And so it just so happened that I could give them all of the explanation as to how addressing ACEs actually decreases preterm delivery, low birth weight deliveries, decreases 44% of mental health disorders, 33% of smoking, 24% of alcohol abuse, and just could go on and on. So that would be success on a national level where everybody would be benefiting from the ACEs screening. And so in California already, we have through Medi-Cal reimbursement for the ACEs screening. So that is huge here. So $29 reimbursement if you go through the training and then you do the screening with your patients. And it's not just physicians. It is the nurse practitioners, the social workers that can bill for that as well.
So that means screening women for ACEs at their annual exam as a preventive service that's covered under the Affordable Care Act without cost sharing.
That's it. Yes.
Let me nudge you a little bit there. So I know certainly screening is important, but screening without actually doing something about it is, you know, certainly kind of raises concerns for a lot of us, you know, who think that we ought to be doing better. Any thoughts about what can follow up a positive screen?
Sure. So, and that's my challenge because I was delivering babies up until the week that I was appointed and direct patient care. And so there's nothing more frustrating than screening somebody and not being able to do something about it. So the great thing about the office is that it has a collaboration with the UCAN, so UCSF and UCLA. And, you know, I asked the question, okay, it's great, we're screening, but you all have the data. You all have the evidence. And I would love to know if I see a 17-year-old in my office or if I see a 25-year-old in my office, give me a QR code that I can immediately share with that 17-year-old so that they know what to do. Like, what is the most immediate thing that person can do? Instead of waiting for me to write a referral, whatever it is, in addition to that immediate support. And this goes back to the fact, and we're all in public health, that 80% of health happens outside of that doctor's office, mm-hmm. that healthcare provider's office. And I am all about empowering and educating the public to help themselves because we can't wait for the prescription, for the referral, for the program immediately. So that would be the one thing, and then that would be a dream. Again, just giving something to the healthcare provider so that they can support the person immediately. I think right now, as things are developing with mental health, we now have the 988 number. We now have the, there's a maternal mental health direct HRSA mm-hmm. number specifically. So I think slowly we're starting to build the pieces. And depending upon where you are, depending on the county, like if you're in LA County, you can call the 211 number and get a whole, they can give you all of the services that you need. And so that would be something to replicate. I know San Diego is doing something very similar to that. So to be able to replicate the best practices, but obviously, you all know it's got to be tailored to the community that you serve, to the population that you serve, that taking all of that into consideration is critically important.
And let's take a dive into the second priority around reproductive health. Right? So both of us are OBGYNs. Both of us have really kind of dedicated our career advancing reproductive health, fighting for reproductive justice. Now that you're Surgeon General, right, for the state of California, what do you hope to accomplish in the next 5 years in terms of really advancing reproductive health and justice.
So part of health is knowledge, right? You don't know what you want and what you can have unless you know what there is. And one of the stark realities of life is that many people do not know their own bodies. They don't know, you know, like, how do they actually become pregnant? Like, can, you know, there's all these myths and misperception. So the first piece, and this is just what I always did with my patients, is education. Give the information, empower them to know and to know where to look for information so that they can get the resources that they need. So one of the things that we've done is created videos. Just go on our website and just on contraception. Because many people don't know what emergency contraception is, just basic education. They don't know that emergency contraception is not an abortifacient. Emergency contraception can be bought at your, you know, pharmacy. And so just simple information to know. The other piece too is that, so education would be critically important. The other piece too is that many people don't know that the health that they're living before they become pregnant really impacts their pregnancy and their outcome. So we have, what is it, a 40% overall obesity rate overall as a country, and women are waiting longer to have their first baby. And that means that oftentimes there's more chronic diseases, and that just starts to add up to more and more risk factors for negative outcomes during the pregnancy. And so again, that education piece and just being able to inform, especially young people, that, you know, just be aware that these are the potential risks. So again, just going back to education. The other with the abortion piece, just to know what is available in California. The governor put out the abortion.gov website, and on there are resources for people who are really in need for abortion services. And it is just an opportunity to realize, okay, we have the support here. In California, the voters have voted to codify abortion services and contraception services into the California Constitution. So the voters have spoken. And then for the perinatal outcomes, the maternal morbidity, we have a lot of work to do with the Black population, indigenous population, really to improve our outcomes. And so lots of opportunity. So again, I think for me personally, success would be if everybody in California at least knew where to go for information that is accurate and they can trust. We're not all going to remember everything, right? But we want to know that we can go to a trusted website and not go to Google or ChatGPT to get the information. So,
well, I know it's certainly been keeping me awake at night, and it's probably been keeping you awake at night as well. I think a lot of us are really worried about access to abortion services after Dobbs overturned Roe v. Wade. I think we're going to be okay in California, but obviously we're very concerned about women in states where it's going to be increasingly challenging for them to access abortion services. How could California help?
Well, California is helping. California is helping by being the role model. So that's the first thing that we have to realize. We're already doing the type of services that the rest of the country previously had. And by being the role model, modeling the fact that you can actually have the voters be the ones to make the decision in your state. The other critically important to not overlook is that this is a state-dependent decision. And so to be able to empower, you know, the residents of those states to let them know, okay, if you want to make changes in your state, these are the things that you have to do. that is critically important because this is not a federal decision. It's a state-by-state decision. So that would be one thing. The other thing to realize, too, is that California is training future physicians, future practitioners. We are seeing the number of medical school applicants increase in California. The number of applicants to family practice residencies, OBGYN pregnancies, OBGYN residencies increasing in California because people want to get a holistic care training. And so if you are in a state that is not going to be allowing you to train you, you're doing the trainee a disservice. And so there's some agreements that are being made so that students can come over to California and be trained. The thing that you also have to realize as an OBGYN is that abortion is a medical terminology, right? And it just has been politicized. So abortion really is the removal of the pregnancy from the uterus. And there are miscarriages, that's an abortion, spontaneous abortions, septic abortions, an ectopic pregnancy that eventually ends up as an abortion. All of these, but are abortions, are different types of abortions, but people just have politicized it to one type of a procedure. And it's important to realize this is a medical terminology. So when people say, well, being trained on abortion services, if somebody had a miscarriage, the procedure that you do is a DNC, and that's not that you're doing an abortion. You're just doing the medical procedure that removes the uterine pregnancy. So it's important to keep all of that in mind and just, you know, this is medicine. And really, we need to remember that the care of a patient needs to be decided upon between that patient and that healthcare provider. We don't need, as I was at a conference, we don't need people on your shoulder telling you and sitting on your shoulder what you do, what you can't do, when they don't know your patient, they don't know your experience, they don't know what's happening in that exam room, but yet we want to have that peanut gallery on our shoulders telling us what to do.
Yeah. Well, abortion certainly probably one of the most divisive issue in our nation today. You just went through your confirmation hearing last week. I imagine the whole issue of abortion came up. How do you communicate to legislators or citizens of California who may hold different views about abortion as you do?
So it's, first of all, again, just remembering it's a medical terminology. And no matter if you're talking about an elective abortion, it's not an easy decision for that person. So, and it's a very sensitive and it's a very personal decision. So we have to keep that in mind and we have to be able to support the person who is undergoing that decision. And so, again, we have to also remember that the people of California were the ones that voted to instill abortion as part of the Constitution. So it doesn't matter what I say or I think. I think what we have to remember is what the voters in California have voted. And that is what really is what the population has said. There are lots of services and support to be able to talk about each piece of the abortion spectrum. And it just is really critically important that we understand each other, listen to each other. But the bottom line is that in California, it really has been the voters and the people in California have said what they want California to do. So whether it's a legislator, whether it's me, whether it's whomever else, the voters of California were the ones that said, no, abortion is going to be part of the California Constitution along with contraception.
Let's talk about maternal mortality, right? We're the richest nation on the face of the earth, And yet we have the one that's, we have the highest rate of maternal mortality among developed nations. And these large, disgraceful gaps in maternal mortality, and whether it's racial, ethnic, socioeconomic, geographic gaps, still exist. California has certainly led the way in fighting maternal mortality, and you've been a great leader of that movement that's really spread across the nation now. Talk about what California's been doing around maternal mortality, and as Surgeon General, what more should we be doing to make sure that we can someday can reach the goal of zero maternal death?
So, you know, we've been working on this for years, and this all started, all of the improvement in maternal mortality started because the California Department of Public Health noticed the trends in maternal mortality were high. And California was one of the first states to do a maternal mortality review. And what that is just looking at the maternal deaths and going through there, making sure that they were coded correctly, because when you have 70-year-old women coded as a maternal death, right? So it's not accurate. So it's a very intensive procedure, very intensive undertaking. And so there is a whole group of the first maternal mortality review looked at the chart and looked to see, could this death, could it have been averted? If this person had not been pregnant, and was there something in the care? So as a result of that, that's where the maternal mortality review was developed in California, and it's data really drives action. And so it was that data that made California realize, okay, hemorrhage is one of the highest reasons for maternal deaths. And so that's when the California Maternal Care Quality Collaborative was granted the RFP to be able to develop a toolkit that focuses on hemorrhage, on reducing postpartum hemorrhage. So that just continued on. And then they came up with a hypertensive toolkit, then with a sepsis toolkit. So lots of toolkits. So all based upon the data. Where are the opportunities that we can make a difference? And it made a difference. California brought our maternal mortality rate down to be the lowest in the country. But like you said, Michael, it's unacceptable that we have this wide disparity gap with the African-American population and the indigenous population. And so we still have work to do. And so as Surgeon General, one of my initiatives is focusing on that piece. And all along, and I'm very grateful that I've seen all the work that has been done, and as a practicing OBGYN and delivering OBGYN, I keep on hearing, I'm not heard. Nobody's listening to me. But it's not just the Black patient saying that. It is every single ethnicity saying the same thing, right? Because nobody feels like they're being heard. And oftentimes, I hate to say it, I mean, physicians have a very short amount of time to be able to take care of all of the problems that we all come into that examining room with. And so I realize, again, going back to the education, we haven't given patients the opportunity to give them an assessment to say, wow, I didn't realize I'm a potentially high-risk patient if I became pregnant. We've been focusing on the system. We've been focusing on the healthcare in the hospital, but we've not empowered the patients enough. And I think that's where the piece that we need to elevate. And so, you know, I'm gonna really be looking at that. What can we do to help empower patients to be able to communicate the fact that they're high risk, the realization that they're higher risk, and that, you know, they need more immediate care. And so if we can identify terminology that patients can understand, and more importantly, they can communicate that to the healthcare system. So when somebody calls up and say, hey, I'm in this, you know, high risk category, the healthcare system knows immediately, okay, you know, we need to see this person faster. So in a subjective way, to really identify who's at high risk, and they really need to be seen much faster because of the fact that they're higher risk. So there's a lot of work that's being done. I know there's some work that's being done at Stanford too, specifically in the labor and delivery. So going to be looking at some of those opportunities and really convening outside the box thinkers to help identify what can we do? How can we push us up to be able to say, all right, we're addressing this. We're on our way to make a difference.
Yeah. But so much of what we're doing in California and around the nation is still like in the clinical realm, right? So let me ask about social determinants of maternal mortality, specifically around institutionalized racism, right? So I travel around this country now for more than 20 years, working with communities like Ferguson and Baltimore and Oakland. And when you actually go into these community meetings, when you listen to community voices, you realize pretty quickly that what's driving these high rates of maternal mortality is the institutionalized racism that's manifest in differential access to not only healthcare, but housing and education and jobs and, you know, the conditions that's kind of needed to assure health and well-being for women, children, and families across their life course, right? And yet most of us who are trained in public health, most of us who are trained in medicine, we don't know what to do with institutionalized racism. So we end up doing the same old thing, right? We end up like trying to enhance prenatal care or to support care coordination. But I actually don't think that we're gonna be able to achieve health equity around maternal health without dismantling institutionalized racism. Right? So what can the Surgeon General of California do about dismantling institutionalized racism?
So I can't do it. I wish I could. But what is being done is through the CalAIM, the Medi-Cal, the really reimagining and coming up with innovative models. And one of those innovative models is the whole person model and addressing the perinatal maternal morbidity, mortality in the Black population is one of those priorities. So the whole model is pulling in what's happening in the community, having the community health worker being with them to help them navigate the system, having all of the other services wrapped around to support those patients. So they are lofty goals. And, you know, I really think that is the reimagining of what healthcare can be, is what the CalAIM programs are doing. So I'm there to support them however they need, but just know that there is work that's being done already, and it's in place to address the whole holistic, outside of the doctor's office, it's everything else around the patient's life.
Yeah. And let me just check with the audience. How many of you have heard of CalAIM? Yeah, this is huge, right? This is transformational. It is, you know, taking the Medi-Cal program, and I think the state is putting in, $12 billion over the next 5 years to like tackle social determinants of health. This means that health plans contracting with social services agencies to go into the homes and remove carpets, remove mold and dust mites to provide help with grocery shopping, to like tackle all of these social determinants of health. So many of us are actually super excited about it, except for one part, right? And the part is that the money actually flowing through health plans, right? And the concern, of course, is now we got some great health plans in California. We also got some for-profit health plans for whom, you know, that there may be certain kind of misaligned kind of incentives. Like, what's your take on that? And do you believe that Cal AIM is going to be able to deliver the promise that it's envisioned to deliver? Or like, is there something that we can do to make sure that Cal AIM actually could do what it's supposed to do to really help tackle social determinants of health?
So I think that's a pilot program. And so as a pilot program, we're going to learn what works and what doesn't work. But at the same time, don't stop doing all the upstream preventive services programs that are already there. There are so many more programs that have been invested and are being made available now that I would say keep promoting that and identify what is working. So it's going to be a combination of things. We have to start somewhere. In terms of the payer, it's got to start somewhere. And then we can say, oh, look, here's another model maybe that we can consider. But we have to get that initial data so that we can see the outcomes and then incorporate, adopt. You know, it's just like the whole PDSA cycle. But starting out with the pilot first and then continuing on. But that's just for that one piece. But there's so much other, so many other activities that are happening in public health, in other community-based programs, that I think those also need to be continued, need to be elevated.
I want to make sure we leave plenty of time for audience to ask you questions. So let me ask you this one last question about your third priority, which is around mental health. And certainly we're seeing this concerning trend in terms of the rise of mental health problems amongst children and youth in our state and in the country. You mentioned this five-year, $4.4 billion Children and Youth Behavioral Health Initiative. Tell us more about it. What are you hoping to accomplish? And again, what would success look like to you 5 years from now?
So this, the $4.7 billion is a statewide initiative. And our office just has two components there. And the two components that we have are focusing on campaign to promote what mental health, adverse childhood experiences are, how that plays a role, recognizing, talking about it, again, just demystifying, destigmatizing, going on the various social media platforms wherever young people are getting their information, and then connecting them with resources. So that is a $24 million investment that our office is leading. The other is developing a curriculum for educators to help them recognize what trauma-informed care is. And there are many other pieces that are happening with the Children Youth Behavioral Health Initiative, but that is one piece that oftentimes teachers may not realize that, wow, maybe the child is acting out not because of the fact that they have, you know, maybe they're acting out because there's things happening at home. And so it's not ADHD. And so just really understanding and knowing how to support, again, buffering, providing those buffering situations so that the child can have a better trajectory in learning, because we know that the adverse childhood experiences, the trauma can change the way that your brain is wired. And so that is that's what success would look like is for our office, because those are our two asks. But the Children Youth Behavioral Health Initiative, the bigger piece, the mental health substance abuse piece, really the success is already being identified by the youth. There are parents that are participating on focus groups, as well as youth from all over the state, specifically also making sure that the voices of the underserved LGBTQ plus, Black, rural, American Indian, Hispanic are heard, and wanting to know how is healthcare, mental health care, how should it be reimagined? We can't do, like you just said, we keep on doing the same thing over and over. Guess what you're going to get? The same thing that you've been getting. So that's why they're doing all of this informational focus group testing and hiring and contracting with technology partners to come up with an innovative way of delivering mental health support because youth have said, we like to interact first with a virtual being, a chat bot, somebody that is not a human, because I want to be able to communicate freely. There appears to be some type of hesitance for somebody to speak face to face, but I have no problem texting, right? Everyone will text each other and communicate. And so that is something that is being taken into consideration in developing the platform and connecting them to support, getting immediate support, and then referrals as well. Making a no wrong door availability for mental health so that when kids are in school, they can actually get the mental health support there. And the schools could bill for the mental health services. So now, you know, we're changing the whole paradigm of where is mental health acquired. So really pulling in the parents, pulling the teachers, anybody who is in the life of a 0 to 24-year-old, pulling that all together. And I'm excited. I hear all the plans and I see what's happening and I think, wow, I think this is really going to work because it is an investment that is being made very thoughtfully and thoroughly. And it really is a patient-centered design. It's pulling in what our end user is going to be wanting to use. And so I think that's going to be very critical in our success.
Yeah, it's a super exciting time to be in California and to be the Surgeon General of California leading the way. Well, let's open it up. Questions for Dr. Ramos? Just go ahead and raise your hand and we'll bring the mic to you. Okay. So let's start right here.
Hi, I'm Sansara. I use the she, her pronouns, and I'm a maternal, child, and adolescent health LEAP scholar here at the School of Public Health. I've worked with Assemblymember Ash Kalra and the California Nurses Association to expand access to healthcare. And unfortunately, like AB 1400, which is like the CalCare bill, didn't get brought to the floor. But like in light of that, I wanted to ask, what is the California Surgeon General's role and the office's role and expanding access to healthcare, and what is your plan to do so?
So I have no role in expanding healthcare. That's a Department of Healthcare Services, our sister agency. And I know that there are many programs that are being expanded. And so I also know the frustration when especially as a student, if there's a bill that you've been trying to support and rally, and really oftentimes it comes down because of financial issues. But I can tell you that's the Department of Healthcare Services. So my role would be, once something is passed, once something is made available, to highlight the services that are available, that will be available. A clear example of that is the Medi-Cal expansion to the undocumented. So we shot a few segments, media segments, radio segments, educating the public, in particular Spanish-speaking community, that's going to be a covered benefit come 2024.
Thank you. I think I saw it.
Hi, my name is Shade. So I come from near LA, Downey, which is like near a whole bunch of cities. It's just like a really large Latino, but specifically Mexican enclave. So in terms of you talking about information as the number one priority, I 100% agree. I've seen it in my personal life and my community that even my own family just lacks the knowledge of how to get resources or what the state actually has. I mean, even being here, hearing the things that you've talked about, I've learned a lot. So I know that there's a lot to learn. And I know you just touched on it right now about that video, but I'm wondering in what ways your office is trying to access communities like mine, the city I come from, the city surrounding in LA, South Central, where we really see a large number of Latinos, Spanish-speaking only communities that do not know this information but need it the most.
So there are a lot of our partner organizations. The California Endowment is going to be having a huge campaign, and they were the ones that are going to be promoting. And so because I'm bilingual and, you know, I tell our sister agencies, is there something that you want me to communicate to the Spanish-speaking population? You know, I tell them I'm happy to do so because, you know, I see the information, I see the resources. And so they're the ones who do the targeting of the information to the audiences that they're wanting to know the information. Now, that being said, that's just one way. So this is where I challenge all of you, especially you're all savvy on social media, is when you see something, promote it. Share it with your communities. Because if it's coming from you, and if your mom gets the information, she's going to read the information, right? And there is no way that I could specifically target everybody that needs to hear the message. But once one person hears it, you're a big influencer in your community, then you share the information. And it doesn't have to be something that I share. If you learn it, why not create, and you're all good at this, a TikTok video or whatever video, and just share it with your communities. Hey, I just learned about this, right? So you are all empowered, and you're here at one of the greatest public health schools in the country. You know, you are, I now tap you all as public health information ambassadors. Take advantage of that role. You learned so much that to not share it would be really a missed opportunity.
I'm going to come to the side just a little bit. So think about your question, but just follow up on that. We're in public health, we're fighting a losing battle against misinformation and disinformation, right? And in fact, so many of our public health officers are resigning, yep, retiring because of all the harassment and threats, mm-hmm, as a result of misinformation, disinformation. Right. Like, what can we do to fight misinformation and disinformation in public health?
So you are all trusted voices within your communities, right? And so I would say, I would encourage you to promote the right information within your communities, within your spheres of influence. We now have the designation on YouTube and, you know, various websites that it says trusted source, right? So slowly we're starting to get that identified. But really, the more, even though that's being vetted, there's a lot more information and a lot more social media sites that are coming up, and people are just they're wanting to believe what they want to see. So I'm going to be looking for the information that's going to be, that I want to look at and going to trust that. I wish I could tell you, you know, and you were, when you were at MCAH, there's a lot to be done, and you're always going to have a naysayer, and, you know, people are always going to want to hear what they want to hear. And you just would hope that your explanation, and that you would be that one of those trusted voices. But like my husband always says, not everyone's going to love you. And so just do your best and just try and hope that they listen to you.
Any questions from this side? Yep.
Hi, Dr. Ramos. My name is Mariah Giles. I'm a second year Master's of Public Health student in maternal, child, and adolescent health. So in honor of Women's History Month and also International Women's Day, I wanted to ask you, reflecting on your career trajectory, what were some words of wisdom that you would give to yourself as a early career professional, as a Surgeon General now?
Well, first of all, happy International Women's Day today, right? We forgot to acknowledge that in the beginning. But I would say is enjoy every experience and don't take it personal. I can honestly tell you when there have been what was perceived as a failure or an outcome that I didn't like. When I look back, I think, wow, I am so glad that happened. and sometimes, you know, we take things very hard. One of the best examples is when I was a freshman at USC. I started out as a biology major. And I remember I had a hard time transitioning from high school to college. I was having too much fun. I went from an all-girls high school to now to USC. And so I think I had like a 3.5 GPA, 3.4 GPA bio. And my biology advisor said, Diana, you have to think of another career other than medicine. This GPA is not going to get you into medical school. So I had never been told, no, you can't do something. My mom always said, you can do it. You just got to set your mind on it and just work hard. I believed her. I didn't never asked her, Mom, how do you know? But I believed her. And so, you know, I said, thank you very much, Dr. Kurtz. And I walked out of his office. And then I looked around and I thought, well, who are the people that appear to be having a good time, happy, enjoying life? And I thought, wow, it's the athletes. And I thought, what is their major? It was a communication major. So I went on to graduate from undergrad as a communication major. Little did I know that that communication degree would be so instrumental to what I'm doing now, all along the way. All throughout my public health career, I have been a media spokesperson, bilingual media spokesperson, and that was that communications degree that opened the door to all of those experiences. So when you think, oh my goodness, you know, I'm not, whatever outcome didn't happen, it's okay, because that door is opening up to something even better. So just trust that it's all going to work out to your benefit.
Thank you so much.
I'll come to this section in just a little bit, but just kind of pick up on the theme of communication. So what are some of the most critical tools, skills, competencies, in addition to communication, have you found most useful to your career?
I think probably is not saying anything and listening. You know, biting your tongue. we have two ears and one mouth. Just always remember that. And just to be able to listen and understand the other person and maybe where they're coming from and why they're saying what they're saying. Their lived experience, we have no idea why. And so I just like to listen and then ask them, so help me understand even more. And so that's been such an eye-opening experience that I would say just listening and understanding would be a critically important piece. And I try to do that even, you know, with my son, who was a teenager. And, you know, something happens and I said, okay, well, what happened? And instead of me like going off and getting angry, like bite my tongue and just listen. So it's something that I do personally and really strive for professionally.
Thank you. Questions?
Yep. Hi, Dr. Ramos. My name is Leslie. I'm a second year Master's in Public Health student in the Health and Social Behavior concentration within Community Health. And I just wanted to shift the conversation back to the priorities within your office in the state. And also to Dean Liu's point about really addressing the root causes of health inequities, and one of the main being the drivers of institutional racism. And within the office, I'm curious if there's any initiatives or just kind of approaches being done to address historical racism, particularly trauma through our systems and the healthcare system. And when we're talking about, you know, maternal health outcomes and ACEs and all these things, really the root of that being not only that individual and community mistrust, but these legacies of harm from systems that we now continue to operate in within public health and medicine. So just curious if there's any sort of intentional work through reparations or any sort of kind of initiatives to address that.
So I can tell you that equity is a North Star for all of the work that we do at the state. And the governor actually came out with a statement saying, okay, all of my agencies, equity has to be ingrained in everything that we do. So we have in our agency, the Department of Healthcare Services, that oversees all of public health, all of healthcare in California. We have an equity division and really just being intentional in not only addressing the people that we serve in terms of equity, but more importantly, who is at the table? Who are the leaders? And you can see by the appointments that we have here in California that really agency, the governor is talking and walking the talk. I mean, by appointing me as a Hispanic woman, I would have never, ever thought that I could be in this position. But I was given that opportunity, you know, when you look at all the experience and everything else, so the equity piece. So in general, that equity is really a focus in terms of not only who is helping make the decisions, who is leading, but more importantly, how are we going to be really deliberate in addressing all of the various populations, rural populations, especially to LGBTQ+, African-American, American Indian. How are we going to make sure that we are bringing them to the table? So overall, that equity is the North Star in everything that we do. There are other programs that are doing a little bit more in terms of equity, but when we're developing our programs within our office, we make sure that everyone is represented, even from the website. You know, when we're creating our website, because now as a Surgeon General, I have the opportunity to refresh the website with various new pictures, various focuses. And, you know, I make sure that our team really has a representation of everyone in California. So in terms of equity, you know, not only the people that we serve, but the people that we help represent.
Thank you, Dr. Ramos, for being here today. This is an incredible opportunity to meet you. And my name is Lori. I'm a fourth-year undergraduate here at UC Berkeley, pursuing my degree in public health. And last semester, I had the opportunity to take a class through our School of Public Health, which gave me an opportunity to work with a variety of community initiatives up and down California, but specifically in Northern California. And one of the areas of interest that we were working with were individuals who are day laborers and getting information out to areas that are technological deserts, so that do not have access to a lot of the privileges that we have with a cell phone in our pocket or internet access. What are methods, because communication seems to be a big trend in our conversation here today, and your priority is to ensure that there is mental health benefits, that there are reproductive benefits, and just overall, the communication of the right information is being communicated to these populations up and down California. So where do you see yourself in the time that you serve as Surgeon General improving those that access to those technological deserts to ensure that they have equitable opportunities to the information that is available to everyone else?
So you bring up a really good point in terms of the technology divide that exists. And I do want to make you aware, as part of the governor's initiative, there are, I don't even know how many millions of dollars of infrastructure that is already happening to try and address that divide, putting down the cable, increasing the internet access. But you bring up a really good point in terms of how do we communicate to those communities that may not have access to the internet. And so that's where community-based solutions come into play. That's where listening to those who live in those areas, they're going to tell us what is going to be the best way for me to communicate with you. And so it could be something like a radio segment. It could be something like when they're, the farm workers are working. It could be in the lunchroom that somebody goes and talks to them. Whatever works best for them. So that's where, you know, as a state, And as you're learning and in your public health work, that we really want to create tailored solutions for the community that we're serving. There is a there is no one size fits all. You know, we can have a great idea, but it's not going to work in this community. So how are we going to tailor it and have that community tell us what's going to work? So for us, one of the things that we're going to be doing is my communications director likes to call it a college tour. And basically it's going from Northern California down to Southern California and really listening and meeting with young people. Like, what are some of the issues and potential solutions that we need to make sure that we communicate with those working in those areas? So, you know, a lot of ideas that have been floated to me, like, what are you going to do about this? What are you going to do about that? I can tell you, we are not a programmatic group, but what I am is that conduit of information back to those programs that are doing it. And I could be the voice to say, you know, that program that you thought you wanted to do on mental health in the Central Valley, it's not going to work because this is what people are telling me. And so being that direct conduit of information is an opportunity for me. And then the other way around too is making sure, like you know, it was said earlier, I didn't know that program existed, is sharing what is being done at the state. So being a two-way communication.
Let me just kind of follow up on Lori's question about immigrant health. Certainly, I remember as an OBGYN resident, and there was a time when I think Governor Wilson or the voters of California passed a proposition that banned prenatal care, and all of a sudden, you know, my patients were gone for months. They didn't come back for months, right? And then in subsequent decades, whenever there's mention of public charge, as right. Kind of what we heard kind of with the last administration, it just generates so much fear among the immigrant population, right? So what can the Surgeon General of California tell immigrants in our state, with or without documentation, about their right to health care in California?
So as you may or may not know, so if you're pregnant, you automatically qualify for Medi-Cal, right? And so it is not considered a public charge to be receiving Medi-Cal healthcare services. So even when in 2024, when undocumented are going to be eligible for Medi-Cal, it is not going to be considered a public charge. So that communication piece is really important. And I can tell you when it's going to happen, I guarantee they're probably going to have me do a lot of media on the news, right? Because we know that's how a lot of the Latino community who may not have the resources to look on the internet or don't want to look on the internet, they rather have their information from television, they're going to get that information through the television, but that information will be relayed.
It's going to be really important.
Yes, it will be.
There was a hand over there. Yes.
Hi, thank you for being here. My name is Shayna Weinstein. I'm a part of the 4+1 program here. And this will just be a really quick question because I know we're short on time. But in your response to Leslie's question, I really wanted to know what health equity means to you when you say it's the cornerstone and the focus of your work. How do you view health equity and what are your main focuses towards promoting health equity?
So health equity for me means having everyone have the equal access opportunity to not only the health care, but the preventive health services. And again, going back to what, you know, I see as my priority, the bottom line is just communicating, knowing and helping the public know what is available. And oftentimes it's like, wow, I didn't realize that I can actually get free contraception through the Family PAC program. I didn't realize that if I'm in college, my student health center will do an ACEs screening on me. I didn't realize that, you know, I can, for whatever reason, you know, you can go down the line on all of the opportunities that are available. So equity, part of it is knowing what's available, but the other is being able to access it. And that's where working with the partner organizations, our sister organizations, really helps build that bridge. And we all together hopefully will improve and make health equitable and available to everyone in California.
We have time for one last question.
Hi, thank you for being here. I'm Renee, second year DRPH program. And I know we have talked a lot about, you know, a lot of money going into different programs and things like that. And that's amazing. I was just wondering on the end of the evaluation piece, like closing it off, like if there are programs that just aren't working, what is the accountability piece in terms of, you know, being able to evaluate those programs and making sure that the money is going to the appropriate places where it should go, into the communities that it needs to actually go in. So just wanted to hear more about what your office is doing, or if you know of any, just in terms of like evaluating and having that accountability to when the money is poured out.
So I can tell you that every program that is implemented has metrics and has outcomes. So they have clear metrics, clear things that they're looking for their initiatives. And the funding does not happen unless there's an agreement that this is what the outcomes are going to be in the metrics. So.
All right. Well, I think you can all tell why those of us who know Diana, we're so excited when the governor appointed you as the Surgeon General. I'm so glad, so proud that California have you as its top doctor to lead the way to help our state become the healthiest state in the nation. So please join me in thanking Dr. Ramos, the Surgeon General.
Thank you.